Yo, what is happening, guys? Welcome back to another episode of the Furcast here. Today I'm joined by a special guest, a very good artist and a friend of mine, and actually ordered a badge from them. Alright, so we're gonna get into the episode right here, and today I'm joined by a special guest, a longtime friend of mine, and badge maker and artist. So we'd like to welcome the one and only All-Star from All-Star's Workshop, so go ahead and say hello.
Hi, guys.
Very well thought. Very well done there. So we're gonna get into the first questions, which is gonna be explaining about who you are, and what you've been doing in the furry fandom, and what you've been doing in the fandom. So, first of all, we're going to get to the question of who the hell you are. So, go ahead.
To be honest, I don't even know. All I know is I'm really good at, I can draw. And I make content on TikTok here and there, usually related to queer things. That's about all I can really do.
Yeah, and you are a badge maker as well. I did order a badge from you. I'll put that right on screen right here.
I make fursuits sometimes.
Whoa, really? Oh, wait, yeah, you did.
Sometimes, yeah. I make partial suits, pre-mades. Usually not many, but sometimes.
Yes, yeah, because your characters are very unique, because they're, at first glance, you wouldn't guess, like, which, like, what species they are, but you wouldn't guess, like, there. So can you actually tell us a little bit about that? Because I'm actually very curious myself about what those are.
Well, I'm the creator of a species called the Saunas, and they're a race of self-aware nuclear androids. And I can't release a whole lot because I'm actually planning on pitching this series to a TV show at some point. But what I can say is that it's a story that takes place in the future, and it's about the robots trying to find out, like, who created them and where they came from.
So it's sort of like an iRobot type of storyline there, where it's like they make themselves, they're aware of that they're robots.
Yeah, they're all aware.
And can you say that they're called Novas, I think, like supernovas, but without super.
Some of them.
So can you actually...
Four of them are Novas. They're the leaders of the race. They're the mother drones, and they're the only four that are capable of repopulating the species. So they create the different courts and drones.
So can you explain a little bit about your characters? I know one of them is named All-Star. You know, it's in your name, and he's right there. So can you explain a little bit about this beautiful man that's on the screen right now?
Well, All-Star has he's a very interesting character. He's very dark in nature, but he's not a bad person. He has a little bit of a rough background. He's clearly gay. And he lived in a secret underground city that was a rebel to the Empire. And he ended up getting sucked out of the water and ejected onto the surface, where he meets a couple other characters and goes on an adventure with them to find out who they are.
What do you mean by water? Like, sucked out of, like, what do you mean by that? It's like, are they, like,
okay,
underground?
Okay, let me start from the beginning.
Are they, like, mole people?
He's a complicated character. So basically, to explain who All-Star is, you have to kind of understand how the Saunas work. There's four different categories they can be under. There's the aquatic drones, the terrestrial drones, the plant drones, and then the aviation drones. All-Star is an aquatic drone. And the aquatic drones have had some conflict with most of the rest of the Empire. And there was a rebel group that decided that they didn't want to follow the rules of the Empire anymore. So they went underwater and created a secret society. And All-Star happened to be born into that society. And he lived his whole life not knowing that there was an entire world above him until he was caught in a current that ejected him onto the surface, where he got caught up in a hole. I don't even know how to explain what it is.
A hole?
No, he got caught up in a lot of political business on accident. And there he met an aviation drone named Bolt, who is a mechanical engineer who works for the kings and the queens who rule the empire. And then he also met Bolt's best friend, whose name is Widget. She is a computer programmer for the Novas. And then he met this strange, scrappy terrestrial drone named Ox, who he's there, but like in a good way. Like he's just kind of like the fun of the house.
He's just vibing.
Him and All-Star get along really well.
He's just vibing. So
yeah.
So what is this whole story take place? Is it like on planet Earth, or is it on a different planet, or is it just in a different universe or a different
It's a bit galaxy? Complicated. It takes place in the futuristic wasteland of Earth. It takes place after a huge war that wiped out humanity. So they're living in ruins.
Oh, no. Oh, no. That is... Oof.
Hey, man, it's not a furry story unless all the humans are dead. Am I wrong?
So would you classify yourself as somebody who's in the furry fandom, or would you classify yourself as somebody who creates a storyline that's similar to the fandom in a sense like that? Because there's someone that I get confused with that doesn't like to be called a furry, and I don't know if it's you, but would you classify yourself as somebody who is in the furry fandom, or just a story, or an author, mate?
I'm mainly an author. I mean, none of my characters are really personas. They're OCs. I try really hard to make personas. I had one named Sunny a while back. I just didn't connect very well to her. I like making fursuits and stuff like that. I just have a lot of trouble relating it back to me. So I consider myself a furry, just a furry without a persona, I guess.
Personaless furry.
Yeah, I'm working on it. I want to get a persona. It's just hard to make one that's not... All-Star is kind of like that to me. He's kind of my persona in a weird way.
Well, yeah, because, I mean, with my persona, I'm going to... It was so, like, it was the shittiest persona at first, because it was basically a gray wolf with little specks of blue and a blue lightning bolt at the tail. It was so generic, and it was a wolf-fox hybrid, or no, it was an Arctic wolf at the beginning, and I named him Frost, and I absolutely hated it at first. But then when I went to a virtual furry con, then I found a panel that was where it was designing personas, and they actually used my persona as an example on how to redesign it, and I took up that design and like him ever since. And I renamed him to Zeus because Frost didn't stick, so. Yeah.
See, that's the interesting thing about personas, or characters in general. Usually when they start, this is no offense to anybody. Sometimes this doesn't always apply, but they never really look just right to you when you first start until you start adding to the character. A design is one thing. The character comes from, like, the personality of it.
Yeah, because...
And you can kind of help that come out over time. It's not going to happen immediately.
Yeah, because I started to... I got some art at first, and I was like, something doesn't feel right. Something... It doesn't look right. Like, I mean, it's... I think I thought it was... Because I was like, how is this going to look at a fursuit? Like, this is not going to look good in a fursuit. This is going to cost a lot more, and I don't see that being a fursuit. So I was like, okay, we have to redo it, but... So I didn't get any more out of them until that con, and... Yeah, it's very hard, because I had a very hard time coming up with markings. Like, I mean, colors were not as hard, but they were still quite a bit, so...
How did you get into the art-making style with regards to the furry fandom in and of itself? Because I could probably assume from that, since you're a very good artist, that you started with, like, not being, like... that you started not drawing furry-related stuff, and that was beforehand. So is there, like, a specific story to how that progressed, or was it just, you know, just one day you decide to start drawing furries?
Funny you say that. I actually started drawing furries before I knew what furries were. When I first started drawing for real, it was in my FNAF phase, and I really wanted to draw an animatronic, and I was trying to think, because the animatronics weren't usually human. I mean, there was Balloon Boy and stuff, but I was like, that's lame. Nobody wants to be a human. So I thought I was going to create this is really cringy. I was like 12. I made a Neon Cat inspired animatronic. So it was a cat animatronic. Yeah. And from there, I just kind of evolved it into a fursona. And then that's when TikTok came around. Then it was called Musical.ly. And I think I posted like one picture of it. And then a bunch of people started requesting me to draw their fursonas. And I discovered that I was. That there was a lot of other people who liked doing it too.
Yeah, I could vouch for somebody. I could vouch for somebody who was in that phase, because I was in that phase. I tried to even make my own fan game with it, with two of my friends, and it was called A Week at Mike's, because it was basically at this Mexican restaurant. It was an exact like replica of FNAF, and like, it never came to fruition. Like, they said, like, oh, we're coding the game. But in actuality, I don't think that they ever got it done. But, yeah, I tried to draw him. And, I mean, I hated it, the drawing. But, I mean, now that I look at it, it's probably better than what I do today. Because, like, I mean, I cannot see myself creating something like that. But, yeah, I could vouch for the FNAF phase. Because I think almost everybody who was born in the 21st century went through that phase. Like, everybody, no matter what.
Especially the queers. I think everybody who's in the LGBT community has gone through some kind of FNAF phase.
Yeah, but so how did you discover that? Was it through like Markiplier or something? Because I was like shown.
Yeah.
I was shown like this. It was during my cooking class during middle school. It was called like Family and Consumer Science or FACS, and it was basically like one of the coolest classes in middle school, where you like got to sew and cook and, you know, design things and stuff. It was a fun class, but there was, after one of the cooking classes, one of my friends showed me the video, and they were talking about this game called FNAF or Five Nights at Freddy's, and I was like, what is that? And then I looked it up when I got back home, and I saw the thumbnail of Markiplier's video, and I always saw that video, and I never wanted to see it because it looked scary, but I finally looked at it, and I was like, oh, this is actually pretty scary, but I was interested in that, and it was, oh my goodness, but once, like, Five Nights at Freddy's 4 or 3 came out, it just went downhill because, like, I don't know why. It was, the first two games are like the best in the trilogy, because they're the old classics, but the later ones were just, I don't know why, but they ruined it. It's just kind of like it's kind of reverse of Star Wars. You know, the older movies always are the best, but the newer movies people seem to think are trash. But yeah, it's just a little like, I don't know how to describe it, to be honest, but I could vouch for somebody joining that fandom because of that. Because there's a lot of FNAF, even FNAF fursuits, because I saw at some con photos.
Oh, God, there's hundreds of them, and they're impressive, too.
Like, I mean, I hate to say it, but it's kind of unoriginal, because, I mean, technically they are copyrighted characters, and that's something that is not really seen for fursuit makers, is copyrighted characters. Like, you don't see anybody in, like, you rarely see anybody in a Scooby-Doo costume, or Scooby-Doo fursuit, excuse me, around a con, because that's a copyrighted character, so you don't really see that much. I don't really like it whenever I see a copyrighted character like that. I don't really know, but I really don't have any say in that, because I don't make fursuits, and I'm sure as hell ain't gonna try, because they're very, very complicated.
One thing, if I don't know if my story will ever take off, but one thing that I was terrified to copyright my characters at first, because I thought that if I did, like, I have the characters and I have the species copyrighted to me. And my main fear with me doing that was that people would be afraid to be inspired to make costumes and stuff like that, because I didn't want them to think that they weren't allowed to. I was terrified that would happen, and it really hasn't. But then there's not a lot of people who are making saunas, because it's not a very popular species.
So is it like an open species, or is it a closed for now?
It's open. Anyone can make one. Basically, there are no rules. Fair. They have to have like a similar like body and like look to like how the Novas look, I guess. And they can't have elemental hair. It's like literally the only two rules.
Elemental hair.
I want them to be as open as possible so people can kind of have fun with it.
Wait, what do you mean by elemental hair? Because All-Star literally has hair.
Elemental meaning like, so for example, the Novas, one of them has water for hair, another one has fire for hair, another one has plant-based hair, although she's an exception because the drones that she makes are plant-based, so like, you can have plant drones with plant hair, like elemental kind of things. One of them has their hair inspired off of the weather that it is for the day.
So how do you get in? So how did you get into the badge making business of the furry fandom? Because I've myself even ordered a badge from you, and I'm just like, wow, how do you make them? Because if with digital versions, you could just, if you make a mistake, then you know, just undo that and just redo it. But with paper and physical ones, if you mess up, then, well, you either live with it or you throw it away and go at it again. So is it just where you put it down on the computer and try and trace it as well as you can, or is it just a combination of luck, or is it just memory?
Well, I do all of them by hand. I've just been doing it for such a long time that I kind of have my steps and stuff down. I figured out how to make them quick-ish. I have to juggle them in with my lifestyle. That's pretty much the hardest thing about it. But I just kind of have my steps down. I have my process and everything down to a T, and it works out just fine. And I've found that if I stick to it, they all kind of have a similar turnout. But I do experiment a little bit, and I've found with each set that I take, I do improve quite a bit. So I'm still improving as I go, just slowly.
Okay, yeah, because I'm looking at the badge right here that I got. I'll put this up on the screen of the badge. Because you can see right here that there's little white marks of streaks right here that, are those supposed to be highlights of them? Or are they supposed to be like reflections off the sun? Or is it just your style, how you do that?
Both. I use the white marks as highlights, as reflections, and I also use them to separate different body parts. So sometimes if there's a really, really dark character with, like, super dark markings, and it becomes hard for you to kind of see where their arm is, so I'll use a really thin liner to kind of separate that so you can see what's happening. I have to do that with All-Star a lot because his main color is, like, a dark gray. It's really hard to see the line art in his limbs, so I'll use that to kind of differentiate between his limbs.
All right, and I could see from here on the shadow, like, parts. Is that actually individual colors, or is that adding onto them? Like, do you have to trace
individual
them?
Colors.
Wow. I mean, those, yeah, and it's just like, did you put the shadows part of them first and just color around those, or was it vice versa, or was it some other way?
Well, the kind of markers I use are alcohol markers, so I can actually overlay them. So I do the flat color first, and then I go in with the darker or alternative color for the shading.
But you aren't 21 yet.
What?
You said you use alcohol. You're not 21 yet. So what do you think is the worst part of badge making, in your opinion?
Well, for starters, when my laminator eats whatever I've been working on for like a month, that sucks.
Oh, what's and the laminator? Sorry.
A laminator is like a preserving tool that I use. That's what gives it that like plastic gloss over it. It just helps to protect it. It makes it waterproof. It makes it a little bit stronger. That's a laminator. It's a machine that puts that glaze over it, I guess you could call it.
I see that. It's like that.
But sometimes it eats it, and then it crumples and rips the drawing, and then I have to start all over again, and that sucks because that's the last thing I have to do. So it means I have to start from the last stage to the first stage, and I hate it when that happens.
So why don't you make, like, copies with them? Or are they just, like, you rather...
Because they're hand-drawn. When it comes to badges, I just think they're more special when they're hand-drawn. Mm. I like to keep them hand-drawn for people.
And what other things did you do? Because, I mean, I saw that at one point you did keychains when you first started uploading on, like, Instagram and stuff. So do you still do those? And what was, like, the process for those?
don't do those anymore. They were a pain in the butt. But to do those ones, I had a UV setting resin base that I would do. And I really never figured out how to properly use it. I would draw a picture by hand and then laminate it and then put it inside of the resin to cure inside of it, which worked fine. It just took forever. And sometimes if the lamination didn't seal properly, it would bleed. And then I would have color going into the resin where I didn't want it. And I couldn't figure out how to get bubbles and stuff out of it. And it was just overall kind of just not a pleasant experience for me. So I just stopped doing it. But if I can figure out a more simple way to do it, I'll bring it back in the future.
Yeah. And you said you tried your hand at fursuit making. How is that type of thing? And do you still want to pursue that? Or is it just something that you want to do as personal? Or do you actually think about looking at it as a career?
I don't think about it as a career. Mainly because it's kind of stressful. Commissions are stressful enough when it's just a badge commission. And then you throw in that you have to get the person's size right. You have to keep in mind that this is no longer 2D. Now it's three-dimensional, and it's much more expensive. And I have a little bit more anxiety when it comes to finishing big projects like that. So I just kind of don't take commissions on those. I do pre-mades, though. I like making them. I just kind of struggle with them a little bit.
So how did you get into the furry fandom in the first place? Because we probably should have covered that first, but I'm making these up on the fly, so I don't stick to a schedule. So how did you get into the furry fandom at first, or acknowledge that the existence and start calling yourself a furry?
Well, I found the furry fandom on Vine. Rip Vine, rest in peace, you'll be forever missed. I found Telephone on Vine, and I thought that was the coolest thing in the world. So I hate to say this, don't come at me, I was like 9. I made a pirate telephone suit, not knowing that these were original characters. I had no idea what the furry fandom was. And then I posted about it, and then a bunch of people were like, you can't make suits like that. And I was genuinely confused. I was like, what do you mean? I thought it was just like a game or something like that. And then they told me that these were original characters that people had made, and they bring them to life in these fursuits. And I was like, that is the coolest thing in the world. I don't want this suit anymore. And I created, I was mainly interested because I already had a character. It was that FNAF thing that existed. But after I found Telephone, I threw that into the dump, and I was like, I want a Dutch Angel Dragon. So I made a Dutch Angel Dragon named Mika. I made my first actual fursuit of her. And then funny thing is, All-Star is Mika, just like he evolved, which is really scary because he went from a 3-foot-tall Dutch Angel Dragon to a 10-foot-tall nuclear robot. And I still don't know how this happened to this day, but it did. And I was known back then as, I created another following on TikTok with her, and I went by, what was my username? I don't even remember. I think it was Aesthetic Alien for the longest time. And then I didn't like my account anymore, so I made a new one. I was a little bit cringy, but it's okay. Everybody is when they're 12. But Telephone got me into the furry fandom. Telephone and Vine.
So you said that I've been to some conventions before. So can you tell us what conventions that you went to and some experiences at that?
It's not a big one. I went, because I live in Iowa, there's nothing here. It's called GameCon. It's nothing. We're like the only furries there. It was very anticlimactic, and I did not really have fun. I wasn't very good friends with the people I went with, moral of the story, go with people you're actually friends with, preferably other furries, because it's not fun when you don't. I mean, it can be, but this situation, it really wasn't.
Yeah, all right. And of course, with every episode, you have to dive into the elephant in the room, which is the LGBTQ and the furry fandom. So, can you tell us like which branch? Because beforehand, you said you were part of it. So, can you tell us if you're comfortable with saying which branch you're in?
I am a non-binary lesbian.
So can you describe what that is? Because I mean, most of us probably know what the lesbian is, but some of us don't know really what non-binary is because it's kind of the well.
Yeah, well, I use they them pronouns. I'm gender neutral, but I like my body. I
He,
like girls
her,
too.
they, them, Zhijim.
Yeah, I use they them pronouns, so I'm non-binary, but I love girls, and I am very comfortable with the fact that I am biologically a girl, so I'm also a lesbian.
What does it mean by non-binary? Do you?
I don't fall into regular gender neutral norms. I don't identify as she, her. I don't identify as he, him. I'm kind of in the middle. I don't really think people need pronouns, but that's my opinion. I don't like being put into a box.
You just exist.
I just kind of exist. It doesn't feel right to be put into a category like that, so I distance myself from it.
You're just like Waldo. You just exist.
Yeah,
Just vibing.
it's nice.
Just vibing.
We do be
You're just.
vibing though.
Yeah,
My glasses are disgusting.
I mean. So, do you actively participate in the LGBTQ community, like through like the Pride parades and like Pride Month and all that stuff? Because I mean, I'm demi and poly, not polyamorous and polysexual, which I've said this a million times, but demi is a form of asexuality, which you don't find any sexual attraction to any gender identity unless you form a close relationship with them. And polysexual is basically attraction to most but not all genders. So basically, I'm not attracted to any masculine genders, but any female, whether it be non-binary, queer, or straight. It's basically I'm all for it. So, what do you think
Wow.
is the how do you think is this the LGBTQ community interacted with the furry fandom in a way? Like, have you seen more acceptance, or is you seen no real
Us,
effect?
a ton of acceptance. It's probably one of the most accepting communities I've ever met, seen, run into. I love it.
So, how has COVID impacted the your business in sort of sense? Because some people, as with fursuit making, it's been more impacted because of quarantine and shipping and all that stuff, and the whole fear about it at the beginning. So, I just wanted to ask you, how has it impacted you personally? With it could be
It
both
is,
furry or not.
sorry.
It could be related to the furry fandom, or it could be just, just normal everyday things.
Well, when the COVID first hit, I did end up having to, I ended up losing my jobs. So I really picked up the pace on commissions because that was the only form of income I could handle. And I was doing commissions before then, but it got serious after with COVID. And one thing that has been a pain in my butt has been shipping. Like, I used to do international shipping, I would ship worldwide, but after COVID, I just can't do it anymore because it's not guaranteed to actually arrive to those people. I can only ship within the US and it's slow, so that kind of sucks. But with all the stimulus checks, people have been buying stuff from me be with their stimulus checks, which I do not recommend. Don't do that. Save it for food. But I appreciate the support. That's kind of how it's affected me, I guess.
Commissions come before food.
Yeah, there's some people over here like, "Oh my God, I just got my stimulus check. Here's like $50." I was like, "No.
You
You need to pay for your food
need
or
to
your
pay to
rent."
live.
Oh, people are funny. Like, I
Yes.
appreciate the support, but sir, you need to eat.
I'm poor, but not that poor. Oh my gosh. Yeah, there was
I
this.
can't. I'm no. Sorry, go ahead.
You are exactly like me with that thing. I have a very bad habit of interrupting people, and that's exactly what I say. What type of Freaky Friday bullshit is this?
I mean, I have ADD. Does that
I
count?
have ADHD, so suck it.
I just get excited.
Well, I get excited
I
and
get.
distracted and confused because it's attention deficit hyperactive disorder. So you could tell when I'm off my
Wait, you
meds.
heard what happened earlier. I was talking mid-sentence. I was like, wait, what were we just talking about again?
It's still like I remember I kicked a nurse in the face once when I got a flu shot.
I can handle tattoos where I get stabbed thousands and thousands of times with a needle, but I can't take a flu shot. I do take flu shots, but like I hate it. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, and every single time, the last four flu shots that I've gotten, my arm is always inflamed. Like it's always swelled up, and I can't like move it like in like a couple of degrees. Like I can't move it back and forth as much. Like I can't do it in a circle as much. Otherwise, because it literally won't let me. And one time it got so severe that I couldn't actually use my arm at all. Like it was literally just dead, and I couldn't move it because otherwise it would hurt so bad. And they just recommended ice, and that just seemed to make it worse. So, and I just, it's happened every single time after every single flu shot. It happened to the last one that I got, and I'm not really, like, I mean, I'm just not really looking forward to the COVID vaccine because, I mean, even just watching a video where somebody gets vaccinated just sends shivers down my spine because it's. Even though it's not you, it's just.
Excited for the COVID vaccination because I actually may be able to
Well, I mean, my mom's already
work
gotten it
properly.
because she's a doctor, so she's already gotten it, the Pfizer one. But yeah, it's yeah, I don't really know when it's gonna be available to us, because I assume that like younger people are gonna be higher on the list than like middle-aged people. But. That's just, I don't
Maybe.
know the plans that politics is gonna do. Alrighty, guys, and with that, we're gonna roll on to the intermission. As always, we're just gonna take a little bit of a breather or break right here. And with the second part, we're gonna finish up the interview and get to the special Beastars first episode reaction, where we're gonna invite Coda and Neo in on the fun, where they have seen Beastars before and I have not, so it's gonna be a fun time here. So, with that, we're gonna head on and have a little break and see you guys on the other side of the intermission. Welcome back into it after the little intermission. So we're gonna get right back into the interview. So, how has the furry fandom impacted your life in like any way? Like it could be positive, negative, neutral. Just how has it impacted it in general?
It's been very positive. It's just made my life a bit more interesting. I've made money off of it. It's helped support me, it's helped build my creativity, and it's encouraged me to keep going with the story I was writing. Because in the beginning, I really didn't think it was going to go anywhere. But the more that I drew and the more that I talked about it, more people got interested. So.
So, how do you think that you're going to see the fandom in the future? Like, how do you think that it's going to progress into the future or evolve in the future? Do you think that you're going to stay in it for a while? Do you think that it's just a temporary thing? Or do you think that you're going to stay for life? Or do you just have no
I'm
plan for
not
that?
really sure. I'm gonna stay as long as there's business here. Although I do really enjoy the people, so probably for a very long time. I've made a lot of good friends here. But I do want to focus on my show that I'm working on. So wherever that takes me, if it keeps me in the fandom, great. If it ends up moving me out of it, that's okay too. I'm not going to move completely out. I like it here.
Just squeeze the lemon until it's dry.
Yeah. Yeah.
We could talk about the rainbow car that you have. I mean, it's nothing
bad. I was joking. It's not very interesting. I was joking.
I mean, it's the gayest thing that probably you have besides, I mean, unless you have like a pride flag.
Nah, the gayest thing here is All-Star.
So, did you want to talk about some of your other characters or anything? Because, I mean, we briefly touched on this at the beginning, about some of your characters, like, especially All-Star, because he seems to be mostly at the front of it. So, did you want to talk about some of the other characters that you have in more in depth? Or are they just evolving with, like, backstories, or is it All-Star the only one that you've created, like, a backstory for?
So, quite a few of them have backstories. Bolts, for example, that's All-Star's significant other. He's a mechanical engineer who grew up in a very, very stable and wealthy household, so he's kind of like the odd one out. Everybody else kind of has a rough upbringing, and he's over here in, like, a mansion. His parents are wealthy. He's a little bit cocky at the beginning, very cocky. He's very book smart, but street smart, he has none of it. He doesn't understand anything about how the real world is. A mama's boy. Doesn't know how to do laundry, probably. Sounds and like then me. He meets All-Star.
Sounds a lot like me.
There's nothing wrong with it. I mean, he's fine. Kind of picks everybody else off who is like, so you kind of just had your life handed to you. And he's like, no, I worked for it, you know?
Sorry, he sounds like a wuss. I'm sorry, he sounds like a wuss. No offense.
What? No. There's nothing wrong with having support from your parents and stuff like that. And that's kind of what I was trying to convey with him. He's had unlimited support from his parents, and he's very blessed to have that.
And is that the one with like the
was not lucky, but
is that the one with like the nuclear symbol on his chest? Correct me if I'm wrong. Is that the one that you're talking about?
Yeah, I need to do a new reference sheet for him.
Because honestly, he's outdated. In my opinion, that's kind of a cool touch. But I mean, I didn't even know that all of them were, you know, were nuclear. Because I mean, one just one little accident, and then a surprise is out for the rest of the world. Well, I mean, in your world, that world can't get any much. It can't be screwed over any much more. So, didn't you have another one, or wasn't there one called Aviator? I think was.
Yeah, he's one of the Novas. So, the Novas are there's four of them. And they are the rulers of the Sauna race. They're the mother drones. They're the ones who are the only ones who can reproduce. So those four Saunas are the ones who made everybody. And Aviator is the king of the aviation drones. So he made Bolts. He makes all of the drones that can fly. He's a blind king. He's really cool. I don't really know. I'm still working on the development, but he's a weird individual. He jokes. He's got a very dark sense of humor, so he kind of jokes about his not being able to see a lot. In, like, good fun. He's very light about it.
He's like a blind monk.
Kind of. He's not a monk. He's more like
that guy from Star Wars Rogue One. Just that blind guy. Just, I'm one with the Force, and the Force is with me.
I wouldn't say he's like that. He's more of like, he's chill. He's relaxed. He's laid back.
He's the ultimate vibe king. The ultimate vibe king.
Yeah, no, he's a pretty vibe guy. Not as vibey as, I wouldn't say Arson's a vibe. Arson's just Arson. That's another one of the characters. Arson is a non-binary ruler. And they're just Arson. That's kind of like the running gag. Like when everybody's like, oh, what's Arson like? Arson's Arson. That's all I have to say. They're a very interesting and strange character. With them, I basically said everything that you think of a normal king and queen, just throw it out the window. Get rid of it. That's it's gone. Arson is a king and a queen, a queen that I call him.
Queen.
That, a queen. And they're gremlin, basically. They're literally inspired off of a gremlin. And they are the embodiment of chaotic energy. They're crawling on the ceiling. They're eating ceiling tiles.
Oh,
they're eating
Jesus.
Out of trash at 3 a.m. They're interesting character. But they're a ruler.
I think you need to call the asylum. I think you need to call the mental asylum. I think one of their patients escaped.
Yeah, they're an interesting character. I had fun writing them. So, and then, well, all four of the Novas are in a relationship. They're a polyamorous. They're polyamorous royalty.
Just a big gangbang of Novas. Wait, they're the only ones that could reproduce, so technically that's correct.
Well, they reproduce asexually, but saunas do, they do have sexual organs, so I guess, yes, technically.
Asexually? Like, do you mean,
well, they're
like
robots, so they reproduce in factories. But the Novas are the ones with the coding that gives them sentience. So you need the Novas to actually make like a sentient drone.
So what's the point of like reproductive organs if you're not gonna be, you know, doing that just for the fun? Excuse me, fucking excuse me.
Just for the fun of it.
Oh my goodness,
it all, like All Star always says, you gotta make money somehow.
Oh Jesus Christ! Now, okay, that is.
Sorry. For anybody watching, this is not a series for children in the slightest at all.
There goes my chance of a PG-13 rating.
Yeah, it's definitely not a PG-13 rating. I definitely not. There's heavy language, there's a lot of sexual themes and like heavy things to do with trauma, depression and stuff like that. So I would not recommend watching it if whenever it comes out.
This or your
stuff?
This or your stuff?
Mine. Like, the series I'm writing. It's called the Sauniverse. That's the species and stuff like that. You don't have, you can still be a part of the species, but when I eventually do publish it as a TV show, I do not recommend watching it if you don't like those kinds of themes. Like,
no offense, but I don't really see how it's going to be a TV show in a sense, because you have to first get a network to be able to get that, and then you have to get into a schedule and negotiating. It's just a whole bunch of business mess. That, I mean, if you're talking about TV shows in like YouTube Red, like in that type of thing, like with series and stuff like that.
I'm talking Netflix. That's where I'm aiming for. I know it's a pain in the butt to get there, but I will. I will.
You like...
I have 11 siblings.
it's cheaper by the dozen, but without the... Actually, no, it's double the craziness.
Yeah, in the case of kids, it is not cheaper by the dozen. It's more chaotic by the dozen.
It's chaotic by the dozen.
Yeah.
Honestly, the second movie was just ruined the series. Because, I mean, I don't know if you ever seen that movie, but, I mean, the first one, that... Like, I mean...
Beastars?
No. What? I'm talking about Cheaper by the Dozen. Have you seen that movie?
Oh, I didn't know that was a movie.
It's a movie. Didn't you know
I don't watch movies. That's one thing. Everybody gets so mad at me for that. They're like, oh my God, have you seen this movie? No, definitely not. 100% not. I've seen the Steven Universe movie and Star vs. the Forces of Evil movie and Monsters vs. Aliens.
Oh my gosh. Oh my God. No.
Hey,
no.
That movie was a bomb.
No.
You wouldn't tell me otherwise.
No, that is, no. My God. People who are listening to this, like, for any of you that were those types of, when you were younger, that went to those, like, places like Blockbuster or, like, Family Video or that type of thing. I don't know if Family Video is an international thing or if it's just a Wisconsin thing, but, oh, my goodness. Just walking in there and trying to find your favorite movies in there. Like, I mean, there was always this one Star Wars movie that I always checked out there. Because we'd get, like, one for the family, and me and my brother would each get one movie to pick out. Immediately when I got home, I'd put that the disc into the computer and just spend, like, the entire afternoon watching it. It was, man, but that place eventually did go out of business because, yeah, it's more
Netflix
online.
Netflix exists now. That's probably why.
Yeah, and there's actually technically one Blockbuster that's left in the U.S., Yeah, there's only one that's under the Blockbuster name, even though the Blockbuster brand is non-existent anymore. All right, so we're going to get into this final couple questions before we move on to the Beastars reaction. So how has the
furry fandom impacted you negatively in a way? Like it could be between like business or career or anything. Like how has it impacted you in a negative way?
Me? Well, of course. I guess my time management skills are poop. So I overly indulge in the fandom and then I forget, oh hey, I have responsibilities outside of the fandom.
I need
That's
to eat. I need a drink. I need to pay taxes. Who knew?
Listen, no need to call me out like that. I forget to eat and drink all the time.
You're gonna be
Like,
the Al Capone. You're
severely,
gonna
it's
forget to pay your
bad.
taxes and go to Alcatraz.
Yeah, I mean, that's like the main thing that has been an issue with it. I just get so absorbed in like the art I create and the people I talk to. I literally just forget to take care of myself.
I could actually kind of like vouch for that, 'cause when I first joined the fandom a couple of months ago, like I like my school work just my school just grades just went and just went all the way down, and like I still got accepted into university with that, but I had to drop a math course, which I thought I had to do all 4 years, but apparently I didn't. I had to only get 3 credits or basically 3 years worth of math, so eventually dropped that, and my parents weren't happy about that because they said that I let the homework stack up and let this whole thing get
Listen,
into it.
man, I
But
mean, you need to go to school, okay? I don't want any
yeah.
little kiddies to take this the wrong way. But it's not the end of the world if you don't get a good grade. The school system is kind of designed in a way that stamps out creativity. If something's not working for you, you shouldn't feel ashamed to do what's best for you. Nobody knows what's best for you better than you do. So it's okay if you don't get an A plus on that test. You do need to go to school. That is extremely important. But it's not the end of the world if you're not good at it. It's not the end of the world. You'll do just fine.
Yeah, because I
You
mean,
do need to go to school, though.
because I thought that with all the universities that I had to go to, that I had to get 2 years of language, and I already had one because of the stuff in middle school. But I always thought, because my parents always told me I needed 2 years of a language, so I went to another year of German, which German can whoop is just absolute garbage. I didn't even make it through a semester because I was just. Like, I mean, it wasn't that I was
I had
falling
a
behind on
similar thing in
homework.
Spanish.
Like, it wasn't because I was falling behind on homework. It was just because I wasn't understanding it. Like, it was just I didn't understand it. Then I got behind on homework, which, but yeah, and then just went down the hole. And then I tried American Sign Language. I was like, okay, this time I'm gonna learn from my mistakes. Nope, nothing. Nope, didn't.
It's
Did the
hard
same
though.
thing.
Language is very difficult to learn. I
Exactly.
mean, I had a similar thing happen to me when I was doing Spanish. Okay, so this is gonna sound nuts. I could read it just fine. Like, I could read and speak Spanish perfectly. The second you told me to write it, you lost me. And that was half of our grade. So I was getting straight A's on the speaking tests and the reading tests, but then they would have you do like an essay or something like that in Spanish, and I would flunk it. And my parents were so mad. They're like, you need to study harder. This is ridiculous. Until they heard me speak it. I can speak fluent Spanish. I cannot write Spanish in the slightest. And I think it's just the way I learn.
Yeah.
But they stopped arguing with me after that.
Yeah, I mean, like the only German words that I know like are Detour, which is the door. I basically know that because detour, like you take a detour, and then Ich heiße, which is my name is, that's basically all that I for sure know of German. That's all basically that I know, and it was, I mean, it just added on a lot of unnecessary stress with that, with, all the things. Like, because I thought that the standards to pass high school were very high, but once I actually, like, dove into it, it actually, and, like, I heard from other friends, it was actually that I was overextending a bit, because I thought, like, oh, I had to take an AP class, like, every year to, to be able to pass, and for colleges to look at me, but, no. I just got accepted and I haven't taken any AP classes, and AP classes are basically college classes in high school, so they recommend that you
Yeah.
take one at least once during your four
I'm in
years,
an
but
AP art class. Does that count?
yeah, I mean, I guess, but I mean, it was just like, I mean, my sister took AP Euro and just the name AP Euro just strikes fear down anybody's spine whenever they hear that at our school, 'cause it is the hardest class. Projects left and right every week and very difficult content is the hardest class to take, and my sister was lucky to get a C in that. And it was, 'cause it just adds on a lot of unnecessary stress if you push too far, but if it in some way also benefits you 'cause you're also doing better than the minimum, but it also adds on a lot of unnecessary stress, so it's kind of a double-edged sword. You can't really fix it, no matter what. If you see the actual standards and you go by those, then you're gonna fall behind at least sometime, and then you're not actually gonna pass it. But if you get a higher standards, then you're gonna be looked at more, but it's gonna add on a lot of stress with that. So it's a double-edged sword in that type of sense.
College is okay. College is necessary, okay? You do need to get a 2-year degree in college, but you shouldn't feel like you have to go to university. It is insanely expensive. You're probably never going to use the degree anyways, and the value of the degree has significantly gone down since the 1950s because now everybody has a college degree. You just need to find something that works for you. You don't need to follow the trends of what everybody else is doing.
Yeah, 'cause literally, for to be a police officer at our local police department, you have to have 60 post high school credits, and that is fulfilled. Like, you can blow past that requirement in 2 years, but my parents want me to go for a 4-year associate's degree, or is it bachelor's degree? I can't remember. Isn't associate's
You
two
got it more
years?
planned out than I do.
But they want to give me a 4-year because they say that I'll get more considered. But I'm. Like, literally, they don't care how many years or what type of degree that you go for in to be a police officer. Like, as long as you have the credits, then they don't care. They just get you on. But
You are more likely to get selected if you have more training, but it's certainly not a defining factor, I don't believe. I don't know a whole lot about that kind of stuff, so I shouldn't input my bias.
All right, and on to the one of the final questions before we head on to the reaction of these stars. This is a very serious question, so you're gonna have to think about this, and you're gonna probably receive some backlash, but here is
It's fine.
Paws or Moz.
Moz.
Okay, why so?
Okay, I'm speaking from an artist's point of view, okay? I really like the detail that goes into drawing teeth. There's different sizes, different animals have different shapes. I mean, the gums, the different colors, the different raggedness that you can get with it. Some animals have tusks, some animals don't. Paws are cute too. I don't know. I don't really get a chance to draw them as much as I do teeth. So I like Moz. I'm a bit biased. I like Moz. Can you not do that, please, cat? Stop it.
Just Kat's like, you're still an asshole.
Lay down.
Right, guys,
She's
so
trying to sit on what I'm working on.
all right, we're gonna transition into the reaction, so we're gonna see you guys in a little bit. We're gonna put the we're gonna mostly record this audio, but we're gonna put it in a little bit in the corner of this to avoid copyrights. We're just gonna be mainly showcasing the audio, but we're gonna put a little bits of it at the corner of the screen, as you can see. But for now, we're just gonna. Can you give us a little backstory on what Beastars is? 'Cause I'm the only person that I know from that is Legoshi, and I
In
don't
short, Beastars is the adult version of Zootopia.
know.
And it's just about the wolf instinct to hunt and that. Yeah.
That the whole series, or is that just the episode?
That's the whole series. I mean, it's like a recurring theme.
All right.
A wolf struggling with his instincts, both with hunting and love. So.
I saw that one TikTok where it's like, oh, my tail swinging, baby, I'm in love, like that thing.
Yeah, that was Jack.
Yeah, I mean, people like to seem to love Jack and Legoshi, but I mean, I just I don't
We're furries, we're simps.
we're simps.
right.
Peekaboo. Stop. Stop it. Stop it.
All right. Well, might as well get into it. So if we wanted to say anything, then I can pause it and we could just, yeah, and say something. So without further ado, let's get straight into it. Weiss. Hey, that's gonna be it. A Netflix original anime series. You okay? Seems like you're having a stroke.
My Wi-Fi made like watching the whole episode.
Yeah, well, what is this? 23 minutes? That is nothing. Hold on. But all right, so let's see. That is loud. That is loud. Okay, closed captioning, suck a dick. And my instincts. He has a very, very deep and, like, authoritative voice. Oh, gosh. Okay, let me just say something. That is very overdramatized. Right there. That role is...
anime.
That is... like, I have to say that's overdramatized. Like, no. You're not gonna fall down that many stairs from just that push. And how are you gonna... like, you're... like, it's... I mean, it's an anime. Everything's overdramatized.
Sorry, I'm drinking Kool-Aid.
Oh, okay.
So, we're just food after all. For you carnivores, is that how it is?
What did I say about captions? Oh. Oh gosh, this is really an anime. This feels like it's straight off of Pokemon. Like I remember every Saturday there used to be on Cartoon Network there was either Star Wars or Pokemon, and this just reminds me of Pokemon. It's like I never really liked that. It was kind of boring, but I mean some people like that, but
I don't really watch anime at all.
I mean, it's just got a theme that... it's just got a toony aspect that I just don't like about it, and... it's, anyway, let's continue. Papers here! Get
one! Devoured? Did you hear? It was Tem from Drama Club.
I know.
But Alf, he was in your club.
We just rehearsed together yesterday.
I bet a carnivore student was responsible.
Well, we can't be sure it was a student.
But it's pretty obvious it was a carnivore.
Sorry to say, but isn't it ironic?
that a drama student was murdered and eaten?
Drama Club was one of the only places where carnivores and herbivores got along.
You have to be really careful, Elf. There is a Grey Wolf in that club of yours, isn't that right?
Goshi?
Well, this sure is ruining my appetite.
Same here.
They're just forcing all the herbivores to... Oh, wait, is herbivore... Oh, wait, yeah. Herbivores is plants. I thought if it was, say, carnivore, that's like, oh, okay, they're forcing them to be vegan.
Yeah, kinda. I guess it makes sense in this situation, though, because they live in a society where the only way to get meat is to eat your peers.
Yeah.
It makes sense. It makes sense, but, like,
Yeah, it is, like, I mean, you don't see that in Zootopia.
Hey,
you don't see anything.
They're at least not going vegan teacher, right?
Like, I mean, I think the only thing that in Zootopia that would be classified towards meat would be fish. Because, I mean, you don't see any fish in there. You don't see
any
fish.
Don't. I don't think you really see any fish in here either. They eat eggs and stuff like that. I don't know. It's weird.
Lego Man.
2 weeks, right? Need to find a replacement for Tem.
Yeah.
I mean, how do we do that? One of our classmates just died.
I still can't believe that it's true. What's Louie doing?
A leader meeting. Are you okay, Elf?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is everyone here? Gather around, please. I'm sure you all know by now, something terrible happened here at school this morning.
No shit.
One of the actors, Tem... Huh?
But, sir, you know that Tem was closely involved with the carnivores in this club.
So?
This is an anime scene, if I've ever seen one. That is more anime than I thought would ever be anime. Just
yes.
The standoff. Alright, let's continue this.
Maybe someone got jealous since he was recently cast in a good role.
You know what? You got a lot of nerve. That's exactly why I...
That's why someone was murdered, because they got the role.
Sorry,
that's exactly.
The silhouette looks exactly like the tiger, I'm just saying.
Exactly.
That's not spoilers, I don't think. I haven't seen the second season, so.
Yeah, that's why
I
got
haven't
murdered.
Seen it. I'm just guessing. It looks like the silhouette, so.
That's why that guy was murdered, because he got the lead role. That's exactly. That's why you would murder somebody. That reason.
Maybe. I don't know. I haven't seen this.
Like, I mean, if somebody slept with somebody, I see that as somebody the reason, but still, I mean, messed up to murder somebody. But I mean, getting cast for a lead role, let it go. Like, I mean,
That species of monkey, of that one monkey, aren't they carnivores? I'm pretty sure they are.
I think you're thinking of the Hunger Games. I think you're thinking of the mutations from the Hunger Games.
Could be. I'm not sure.
But I don't think so. I think they eat mostly plants, but I don't know. They could be herbivore as well, but they just like to be they could eat a combination of that, but I don't know. But let's get in.
I can't stand herbivores.
Oh, want to fight?
Hey, I can't crack these walnuts. Where's Legoshi?
Legoshi? It's Legoshi, not Legoshi.
But it's true. Legoshi's not here. Wonder what could have happened. I'm scared. It's like those eyes were looking at prey.
The stalker.
I swear that wolf is telling me that I'm next.
Oh, come on. Legoshi's a bit strange. That's all it is. If you need anything, come by my room anytime. Lemurs are always cheerful and fun to be around.
Thank you.
Good night.
Yeah, good night.
Why doesn't she hear that? Why doesn't she hear that? Why doesn't she hear that?
She does. She does. She's turning around.
No, no, the person that's walking away. Why doesn't she hear that?
And, oh, I don't know.
And where are the cops? Call the cops! You should have a phone on you. This looks like it's modern history. Like, you should have a phone on you. Like, call the cops or get inside. If you think. Okay, now that's clearly Legoshi. That is clearly him.
Yeah, no, I don't think Legoshi did it, because the silhouette is totally off.
Run inside!
Go away!
Or call the cops! Don't... Call the cops!
You pretend to be my friend just so you can eat me when you get hungry? Don't underestimate me! I'll use this! Tam and I are tougher than you think!
And there's the end of the story. Roll the credits.
It's a love letter. It's for you.
Oh, that effort!
I was waiting around out here until you were alone.
You wanted to give this to me?
Oh, that's from the dead guy.
I knew that he never got the chance to give it to you himself.
I thought they were brother and sister, but apparently they're just lovers.
Not really Legoshi. Loves to make, like, couples that are supposed to be each other look like siblings. That's one thing I've always noticed. Sorry.
Sorry.
You said sorry and he said sorry! What kind of sorcery is this?
I shouldn't have said anything to you at all.
Mm-mm. I appreciate it.
Well, I gotta go.
Like the clouds never stay. Hey! I said some bad things about you. The truth is, you're a generous wolf. I'll make sure everyone knows. Please forgive me.
Forget it.
That is such an anime trope.
Exactly.
The truth is...
Oh my god.
How many animes has that been said in and how many times?
He looks so dead on the inside. He is just done.
Wait! The truth is... That is such an anime trope.
I feel sorry that Tem's first love was revealed after he died.
I know. And I understand that. But it's just not fair.
Oh, do you now, sweetheart? Oh, do you?
To you.
It wouldn't really change anyone's opinion anyways. I'll be just fine. Feared and hated. That's the story of my life.
Awkward.
Why is there soda there?
Back to the drawing board?
It's just not the right time. Don't worry. I'll wait for the perfect moment to tell her my feelings.
Tem, I told her.
Look, it's Louie! The star of Adler! On stage and in real life!
Oh, I don't feel like he's going to be one of the spoiled rich kids that just feels like everything is supposed to be done for him.
I'm getting... I think he's at least bi.
I'm getting that vibe from him.
The gay panic in Legoshi's eyes, though.
He's just like,
ooh.
What are you doing here? You just interrupted.
Just his voice and his gaze.
See?
He must have it all down.
I don't.
It's gay. It's gay. Gay. It's gay. Well,
of course he does.
You know.
It's Louis. He's only a year older than me, and he's the lead actor and pretty much runs the school.
You're staring.
Oh, sorry.
Is rudeness something that's inherent in wolves? You're the pup in the art department. I've got a task for you to do. Come on.
Yep, my vibe. Sure. Yep, as I predicted, he's an asshole.
I'll start that way.
Yeah, focus on the lower half.
Anime.
Why and how? When does that happen? Who? I'm assuming that fell from a balcony or something. But when will that happen? Ever in life? I'm waiting. I was right, from a balcony. Who builds a balcony right next to a flowers? That just doesn't make sense. And how will you target that? That's at least a couple stories up. That's how will you target that directly? How will that land, like, right where you... Because, like, a couple... Like, 1 foot away, and that's going to be a assault charge. You know, that's going to hit her straight on the head. So, well, realism is something that
me over
isn't.
Here, like, well, if it wouldn't kill me, I'd let it hit me so I could charge him and make some money off of it.
Okay,
sorry.
Now...
Okay,
now they're the jerks.
Of course you're fine. There's always a boy who will come along and rescue you, right?
Now they're the jerks.
They were pretty blooms.
Oh, gosh. Now they have this. It's just like that, where's that Pokemon thing? Or like, who's that Pokemon?
You guys can't hurt me, so I don't know why you even bother trying. Huh? Maybe you would just rather move out then. This is ridiculous.
You tell me, sweetheart.
Mattresses for rabbits are really that small? I'll give you a hand with that.
I wouldn't. That's Haru.
Thanks, but I can do it myself.
Wow.
Agree down to become a loner beast? 1, 2, 3, 10 letters. Sally. Could have stopped them if you were here. She's kind of pissed off right now. It's best that you leave her be for a bit.
Thanks for the warning. You want to get some dinner?
Like with you? I think I'll pass.
Okay.
Wow.
10 letters to become a loner beast? Is it carnivores?
Ostracized.
Ostracized. That's it. Thanks a lot, Haru.
Whatever. Can I sit there?
Sorry, I'm saving a spot for my friend.
Hey, mind if I sit here?
Oh my gosh.
No matter where I sit, delicious food is still delicious.
That is just like Diary of a Wimpy Kid, the beginning scene where they just can't find a seat.
Am I the only person who, like, willingly sits alone
no,
when I have
not.
To eat? Like, I willingly, like, someone's like, can I sit here? I'm like, no, please don't. I'm insecure. Please don't sit next to
I'm kind of the same. Like, unless there's somebody that I'm, like, in a friendship with, I don't sit next to them. Laura, I don't sit next to anybody.
I'm paranoid they're going to hear me chewing or something like that, so I just sit alone.
Or like if they're going to, like if you're on your phone and they're going to see what you're watching. And you, like, you know that it's not wrong or anything or inappropriate. They just,
you like to vibe you'll on my own when I eat. Like, I just kind of like to be on my own.
Like, I mean, yeah. I'm getting that jerk vibe.
Wow, I'm impressed. The whole school's ignoring you, and yet you sit here still so strong, Haru. A little risky, wouldn't you say? For a bunny rabbit like you to sit alone after that student was devoured like your lunch. Suddenly, the food doesn't taste so good. Rather than spreading rumors about me, maybe concentrate on getting back together with your boyfriend.
Huh? Oh!
None of that is actually.
Ooh, you just hit a nerve. That is, woof. Ooh, turn it up in here. I think it's getting a little warm.
He's the one who kissed me. Besides, a guy who gets excited over one little kiss kind of tells you something, doesn't it? Excuse me.
I wouldn't blame him. That is too much.
Rabbits, which makes us an endangered species couple. You are nothing compared to us, a common dwarf rabbit who's trying to destroy.
Well, then how about we make you extinct?
A couple with obvious pedigree. I guess I'm just going to have to tell everyone at school that you're fooling around with other guys. Let's go.
That's too far. The shove, I can totally see a slight bit of justification, but don't kick a dead horse.
Have his costume fitted by tomorrow's rehearsal.
What?
Zoe is Tem's replacement. We selected him at yesterday's leaders meeting. Right? Yes. How ironic to see you here, Odie the Water Spirit.
Huh?
We're rehearsing. Give me Odie's lines.
Oh, right. I'm sorry. I haven't learned it.
What is it? Open wide.
Oh. That is so anime. That is so anime right there. That is also
detailing.
That is also a good background saver right there.
Now.
Ew.
That is all that goats like you are good for, isn't it? Eating paper? This isn't the place to go around showing off, you know.
I'll memorize it by tomorrow, I promise.
Louis! Zoe doesn't deserve being Tem's replacement. I was runner-up at the auditions, so... Don't you knock? Now get out and memorize the script.
Okay.
Hey, what are you doing in here? Don't you just work on the stage crew?
Well, I guess I better get going, too.
No. You stay. Kai, you and Legoshi need to get along. You two will be working together in the art department. We made a decision during the meeting. You're off the actors team.
Ooh!
You'll support us by working behind the scenes in the public relations sector of the art department.
Hey! Did everyone complete their warm-ups?
Spring Breeze second act choreography. Winter Safari Tournament Final Dance. I know that those two references stab you like a dagger. Right, Kai?
That is so anime. Those right there. Anime check number yours, two.
Your most memorable ones in the past 2 years.
Definitely
not
anime.
Exactly a good legacy for an actor.
Make that number three.
I am curious about one thing. How could you possibly think you could replace Tem?
Actor safety first. That's the job of the stagehands, right?
Number four.
Kai, he's the star.
Who the heck do you think you are?
Well, I'll let it go at least this time.
Must be nice being rich. Nothing ever harms you. What are you looking at?
Pissed.
showing your fangs as a means to actually avoid a fight? How curious. I figured you was a quiet tree, but you have a savage in you.
Excuse me.
Of course, the tail.
Excellent. You seem like you are going to fit right in. Listen, we'll sneak into the theater later tonight and rehearse the scenes with Zoe.
What? But what if we were to get caught?
That's why you're going to be the lookout. What's wrong? You gonna turn it down and put on some kind of good guy act? Disappointing. And what if I were to offer you one of my legs? You'd salivate and happily accept, am I right? You're a wolf. Take advantage of that. Let's see your dark side.
It's dry enough.
Flush! You don't flush.
Guys, take one look at me and tell me they want to protect me and be by my side like annoying pests. When they realize their fantasy was wrong, they just run away. I've been living my life as a plaything for all kinds of guys.
Are you saying that you're
a... Yeah.
Someone who sells their body on the street.
18 up.
Prostitute. Someone... She has a lot of partners. Which is fine.
She yiffs a lot.
Yeah. There is a yiff scene, so...
In this?
Well, it doesn't really... Yeah, there is.
Okay, then that's...
I'm not sure if it's in this episode or if it's in the next one, but there is a iffy scene.
A yiffy scene?
Yeah.
Alright, well, it doesn't look like it's in this episode. It looks like it's in the next one.
When Louis goes in to talk to her.
Gonna get shut down. And then I'd get suspended. Nope. Come on, guys, hurry up. Security's been patrolling a lot ever since the incident. Hey there, little guy. What are you doing out here? Well, that's what I should be asking myself.
Oh, this is just like Zootopia. They just have that little... Oh god. Oh god, what is this? Some hentai.
An herbivore.
Ugh. No. That is definitely anime. That is so anime. That is so anime.
Are those who can act upon their instincts like that and yet still exist in this world? I'm not even good enough to be a loser. You should just take me. I don't care anymore. But even with this sad life, I still had a reason to run. I cried because I was scared. Even I experienced all those things. But will you understand?
What a cliffhanger, eh? A cliffhanger. Well, I'll say that was something. Something that I don't really have a thing for anime, but I mean, it's okay, but I mean...
I really don't either.
It's...
I'm more of a, pop anime kind of thing.
It's something. I'll give it that.
American animated TV shows.
I'll give it that. It's something. It is something, but it's not a favorite of mine, I will. But, I mean, it's one of those shows where you just, like, you don't...
You have to watch it if you're a furry.
Well, well, it's just like you want to stop watching it, but you just... There's something that you just can't, like, you can't stop watching it. You have to know what happens, even though it's... Like, he's, like, in the back of your mind, like, oh, this is stupid. I don't really care about this. Like, it's one of those shows.
Yeah, really give it a ton of praise. It's not the best thing I've ever seen in the world. It's that.
Mm-hmm.
It's there. It's all right. It's not great, but it's there.
Yeah. It's not Grammy worth, but, I mean, it's...
No, it's not. I mean, it's decent. It's an anime. I mean, it's...
When was the last time
furries like it because it has furries in it. It's nothing to be, it's nothing to get, it's not, I've seen better. I'm not even going to lie. Beastars, it's all right. I'm more of a Steven Universe fan, but that's just my personal opinion.
I mean, that series, I saw like a first episode of it. At that point, I was just like, it's fine. It's fine.
That's Steven Universe?
Yeah, I mean, everybody was gushing over it, but I was just like, it's fine, okay? First episodes...
It's one of those TV shows that beginning is trash, okay? Like, the beginning is terrible. But then at the end of the first season, like, it actually starts to get good. Like, the story actually builds. The beginning is just shit.
No, I actually am going to disagree and say that it's the opposite, in my opinion. It's just the first couple are just fine. But it just goes
Steven
downhill.
Steven Universe?
Wait, what show are we talking about? Yeah, Steven Universe. The first couple episodes, fine. Like, I remember what they are. I mean, it's a good storyline, but it's just... It's just goes down. It just... I lost interest in that, and...
I mean, I like TV shows that have a plot and have a direction and stuff like that in it. So, I mean, it's decent. Now that I rewatch it, I can go back and see, oh, that was foreshadowing. Like, yeah, I can see that. That's foreshadowing. Like, I can see the build-up to the main event. But when I was first watching it through the first time, I had a lot of trouble, like, getting hooked because there was no storyline or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, for this, I mean, you can't tell by the first episode, like, what the storyline is going to be. Like, unless you see the next one, and even then you might not get to understand it for quite a bit until you get quite a bit into the season to know what the storyline is. And it's just one of those shows. Because, I mean, for, like, Star Wars The Clone Wars, there was basically, like, they had, like, 3 or 4 episodes where it was, like, a little story, but then it just completely shifted topics, and sometimes it was just one random episode, and then it just shifted topics immediately.
Filler.
It's kind of just those...
Filler episodes.
Yeah. And, like, I mean, even, like, the new season of Star Wars The Clone Wars, it is, like, the only one that you could tell that has a storyline, because it was going up to... It was kind of that transition in between, like, from the last 6 seasons and up to Revenge of the Sith and Order 66, and eventually, that thing. That's, like, the only season I see with, like, a... applicable storyline to the
I'm
movies.
I'm so sorry. I know nothing about Star Wars. I'm a little lost.
It's basically the Clone Wars is basically between Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith. It's basically the struggle between the two sides. And
It's like a war thing. I've been wanting to like.
That's why it's called Star Wars.
I just.
What do you think? It's called Star Wars for a reason.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
Yeah, but I mean. I mean, Beastars is, it's like, I mean, from the first episode, you have to understand, like, I mean, it's kind of, like, similar to Stranger Things in a way. You have to see the episodes to get the storyline. Like, in a way, like, you could see in Stranger Things, like, I mean, oh, they're searching for the missing boy. In this one, it's kind of unclear whether, like, what the main storyline is. But, I mean, I'm just gonna have to see the next episode to... I know what it is, so... I mean, you've already seen the whole thing, so I don't want you to spoil it.
The whole thing, just the first season.
Yeah. Wait, do they have a second season?
Let me see.
I think. I have no idea. I am not interested enough to watch it.
They only have one season. So, yeah. You've seen all of them.
Do they? Yeah.
What were you going to say?
See, I mean, it's good. It's a good anime, but the main... Like, I can see how people would really like it, but the main issue for me is it is not quite in, like, my interest range. Like, I'm more into, like, post-apocalyptic action kind
of
stuff.
Yes, I am also kind of...
This one's not it.
Yeah, because, like, I don't know why, but I'm also, like, a fan of, like, you know, those, like, disaster types. You know, like, San Andreas and, like, those type of disaster movies were something, like... One of the movies that I like, it's kind of like those movies that you want to see, but you also don't want to see because you don't like what happens, but it's also, you kind of do like it. It's kind of, it's called Olympus Has Fallen, which is basically where North Korean terrorists take over the White House. And it's like, it's just kind of like you feel bad for like the Secret Service guys that get just gunned down from all those. Because you think like, oh my goodness, can't they do something? They're supposed to be the best people. And like the whole... Like, United States, but you know, right here, they're just looking like they're absolute scrubs. It's, like, it's one of those things, like, where it's, like, where the people who are less technologically advanced or, like, who are not as powerful have, like, the upper hand in that type of thing. And it's just, it feels kind of wrong in a way, but you just can't stop watching it. It's just one of those movies where you kind of feel bad for the people, like, the background characters. But yeah, if you haven't seen Olympus Has Fallen... Oh my goodness, it's a movie and a half. It's a good movie, but I mean it's like I really don't like to see it.
With movies, I have a lot of trouble keeping focused long enough to actually finish it.
Yeah, I mean there's just
I get distracted. Like I can watch something that's like 20 minutes, that is my max. If it's over like an hour, you've lost me.
Yeah, we've been going for 2 hours and I think it's probably the time we wrap this thing up, so.
Yeah, I have some things I have to attend to on my Discord, too, so.
Yeah, so is there anything else that you wanted to do before, you know, we cut the throat on this thing, or?
Not really, that marker's dead. Not really.
Not really, that marker's good.
Yeah, that's... no, that one's dead. Now I have to try and find the other one.
Where's Waldo? Where's the marker?
We're about to find out. I found another one. Watch this one be dead, too.
Yeah.
You know, got a little bit of juice.
What now? Did you say a little bit of juice?
Yeah. Where's my other blue gray?
It sounds so wrong. It sounds like you're saying blue gay. It sounds like you're saying. Huh? It sounds like you're saying blue gay. I'm like, oh gosh.
It's blue gray.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. This is getting out of hand. I'm just gonna.
God, do they not know that doors do not need to be thrown into a third dimension?
What now? What are you talking about?
My siblings are slamming doors.
Oh, man. I remember one it's like, time.
Hey, you want to see what I can do? Completely destroys door hinges.
Yeah, I mean, this is totally out of subject, but I remember one time I was so angry. One time I actually kicked a hole in the wall, and it's still here. Like, it's still here. I tried to cover up with my desk, but it's still there. It's technically not a hole. It's more like a dent.
I need to get a new desk so bad. Sorry, that's off topic. I heard desk and I was like, oh, I need a desk.
Well, I mean, I got like almost every single thing in my room from IKEA, no joke. And I mean, it's...
Oh, God, the desk that I'm looking at, it's a drafting table and I'm dying to get it.
I mean, IKEA is not that bad to get. I mean, it's basically like, I mean, I'm a very big Lego type of person. So, I mean, I have no instructions and these were kind of similar to Lego instructions. So it was not as, like, difficult because I was, like, I'm used to Legos and all that type of things. But, I mean, yeah. I've only helped build my desk and my drawer over there. I mean, I got to give props to my dad for building that, for building the bed right here. Because, that's a hard day's work. But, I mean... IKEA is not that bad. I mean, one thing that I would say is price. And you do need quite a lot of space to transport that.
And then put it together.
Well, I mean, to transport the boxes. Because, I mean, to ship it, that's like more expensive than the thing itself, because, you know, it's such an awkward package. Because it's such an awkward package, and unless you have, like, a big car, it's not going to fit.
I have a truck. We just don't live anywhere near an IKEA, so...
you won't get any Swedish meatballs, but there's about, I think, a 1.5 hour drive to the cities from where I live, and there's an IKEA there next to the airport, so... You can see, like, the planes taking off from outside, and... Yeah, it's...
That's pretty cool, though.
Yeah, I mean, I actually just went there. I totally wrecked the car on a snow pile. Well, it didn't wreck it. It just popped the bumper out a little bit. But yeah, it's just. I mean, we got it fixed. So, I mean, there's two cool plane watching spots. There's this, like, the cell phone waiting lot where you basically wait. If you're waiting for, like, somebody to arrive, then you could just wait there instead of just driving around in, like, the arrivals area. And then there's an official actual plane spotting area where you could just, like, watch the planes land. It's, like, right next to the runway. And sometimes these big, huge, like, freighter, like, 747s, like, come in and land. And you're just, like, right next to them. And there's just these big, huge planes. And the cargo area is right next to you. So, yeah, you're going to... It's, and you could, like, see all types of... Since it's a Delta hub for Delta Airlines, you could see, like, a lot of the Delta fleet there. And, yeah, it's just a very good place to just, like decompress or, like, just to think. But, yeah, it's about a 1.5 hour drive there. So, the traffic is not that bad, but it's a pretty good peaceful spot in the summertime. But in the winter, it's kind of cold. But, I mean,
yeah. All right, well, we're going to wrap this up, everybody. So... Big thanks to All-Star for joining me on this episode. This went for way longer than I thought it would be. And my laptop is about to die. This is going to take a forever amount of time. I do best grammar. I have the best grammar in the whole wide world. This is going to take forever to edit. So this is gonna be a little bit of time before it. But this is being recorded on New Year's Eve. It is 10:44. In a couple hours, there's going to be 2021. So hopefully we'll say goodbye to a lot of terrible things. Because 2020 was the worst year in entire
human... Well, think of it this way. You thought 2020 was bad. 2021 will be legal drinking age.
For the people in the 21st century.
Well, no. I mean, like... If 2020 was 2021 is able to drink, it's 21 years old. Get it?
Yeah, I know. Once again, I'd like to thank All-Star for joining me. Any last words before we cut it here?
Eat ass, smoke grass, sled fast. That is all.
I'm so mad that can't be edited out. So I'm just going to leave it at do what you do. And, yeah, so, yeah, nice memes, and it's been a very good time. We got a lot, we discussed a lot from Beastars to furries and everything in between. So, thank you guys for listening again. Finally, thank you to All-Star for joining me. Thanks to Thunderhouse Studios for being the partner of this podcast. If you want, go check them out in the description below. I'll also put All-Star's links to social media in the description below. So, yeah. Once again, I'd like to thank you guys for tuning into this episode of the Furcast, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace out, everybody! If you're black or